Hi everyone, today we're going to be going over the Cnidarian phylum of invertebrate animals. So Cnidaria include not only corals, which is unfortunately the only thing you might hear of if you're in a paleontology class, but also sea jellies and anemones. The reason corals are mostly focused on in a paleontology class, or for example in this video, is because in paleontology, which is the study of ancient things that become fossilized, we have to focus on the things that actually can fossilize. Sea jellies and sea anemones don't have hard skeletons and therefore don't get preserved very often in the fossil record. And so corals have a very extensive fossil record. And for that reason, we'll be focusing mostly on them in terms of classification, fossil record, morphology, etc. in this video. However, we will touch on all three groups as we discuss how Cnidaria reproduce and their ecology, etc. before we get to the paleontological details. So in terms of Cnidarian distinctive characteristics, one common characteristic that all Cnidaria have is nematocytes or stinging cells. These stinging cells help to paralyze their prey or predators, and this is a beneficial characteristic that helps them live longer and reproduce more and therefore more evolutionarily successful. Additionally, they are mostly sessile filter feeders and they have no head or tail end. This is even true for sea jellies, or as you might know them, jellyfish, but the more technical term is sea jellies, which may not seem technical, but they're not fish. So they're sea jellies. Even these animals, which seem to be going in one direction or the other when they float, they are actually just drifting at the mercy of the currents. It doesn't matter to them which direction they're facing because they have no head or tail side. Lastly, for the general characteristics of Cnidaria, they have a single enteron where everything goes in and out the same opening. Now to get into their morphology, Cnidaria have true tissues, nervous, muscular, and reproductive systems. But unlike higher animals, they lack discrete organs and excretory, respiratory, and circulatory systems. So they're a little bit more complex than the last phylum we went over, which is periphera or sponges, but they are not as complex as further phyla that we will go over later in the future in terms of invertebrate animals. Additionally, they have two cell layers, an ectoderm and an endoderm. And in between, they have a non-cell jelly material called a mesoglia. The endoderm cells are responsible for digesting food that enters the digestive cavity or enteron, like we talked about in the last slide, and the ectodermic cells are responsible for secreting the skeleton in a cnidarian that has a skeleton, like corals, for example. But in the soft body cnidaria, the ectoderm is just the outer layer of skin and secretes things like tentacles instead. So if we look at the figure to the right here, we have some of these characteristics circled in this diagram. We have here the mouth or enteron, and then the stomach, and then we have the mesoglia in between the endoderm and the ectoderm, and then we have the ectoderm containing the nematocytes, which are these stinging cells, and these stinging cells coat the tentacles, which are made up of the ectoderm. So now that we have a general idea of the morphology or body layout or anatomy of Cnidaria, we can talk about reproduction a little bit. So in terms of Cnidarian reproduction, most Cnidaria alternate between sessile and mobile lifestyles. These two different lifestyles or stages in their life cycle are called the polyp stage and the medusa stage, respectively. The polyp stage is the sessile, non-mobile lifestyle where they are attached to a surface and they reproduce asexually by budding. Whereas when they are in the medusa stage, they are free-floating, mobile, sea jelly-like animals that can reproduce by releasing eggs and sperm to form a planula larva, which can grow into a new polyp and repeat the cycle. And due to the relative differences in different types of cnidarians, most jellies spend most of their life in the medusa stage, and most hydras, corals, and sea anemones spend most of their life in the polyp stage attached to a substrate. And in terms of distinctive morphologies of these stages, they might seem like they look very different if you think about a polyp jelly versus a mobile sea jelly. However, if we look at their actual structure, we can tell that if we just flip the polyp over and detach it from its surface, it looks quite like a medusa. And this is just to indicate how similar they actually are. And to go over some of the other shared characteristics in this figure, we can see that they both have an ectoderm, a mesoglea, a digestive cavity, an endoderm, and a mouth or enteron. And so they're very similar regardless of their stark differences in lifestyle. So getting into classification, just so we can understand the different main classes of Cnidaria, we have here the first three classes, which are Hydrozoa, which commonly remain in the polyp stage, Cubozoa, which include common box jellies, and Scyphozoa, which includes a lot of the other jellyfish or sea jelly species. But as we can see on this page, these all look pretty soft-bodied. So what about the hard-bodied, more paleontology applicable Cnidaria? Well, these are in a class called Anthozoa. Anthozoa includes a subclass Octocorallia, which includes things like sea whips, sea pens, and sea fans, which have a pretty good fossil record, but the best fossil record is seen with the Zoanthiaria. Zoanthiaria include the three main types of corals we'll be talking about, which are all orders. So we have phylum Cnidaria, class Anthozoa, subclass Zoanthozoa, and orders Tabulata, Rugosa, and Scleractinia. So to get into each of these in more detail, we'll have a slide on each. So first we'll talk about Tabulata. These were the first corals to begin to dominate in the early Paleozoic. They evolved in the Ordovician and they existed until the end of the Permian and went extinct during the Permian-Triassic extinction. We can see in the structural picture to the bottom left that they have corallites, tabulae, and dissepiments, although dissepiments are not labeled here. But basically the corallites represent each skeletal cup, if you will, from each of the polyps in the coral as a whole. And so each one of these little cups in the skeleton or polygons in the skeleton represent a preserved coral-like structure. And then we have the tabulae, which are these horizontal table-like layers or laminae in each one of these tabulate corals. And this is why they're called tabulate corals. And then they also have dissepiments in some tabulate corals where they have vertical separations in between their tabulae. The three main types of tabulate corals shown here are the genera, which is the plural for genus, syringiomorpha on the top, which looks like a bunch of straws held together, and these were important reef builders in the Silurian, and then we have favicides on the bottom left, which is the one we were looking at the structure, and these were important reef builders in the Silurian to the Devonian, and then we have halicides to the bottom right, which were never dominant in reef building per se, but they were very widespread and dominant in terms of just living. They don't have to be part of a reef to be an abundant and dominant coral. Moving on to the order Rugosa, we have here what is nicknamed horn corals because most of these corals were solitary, so they weren't colonies of different polyps. They were one and they were in these shapes of horns. However, they did have colonial genera, such as the bottom right image where we have Hexacorals. I know, crazy name, but it's the name of this colonial Rugose coral, but most of them were more like Heliophyllum and Zaphrantis in the left side of the slide. And these were solitary, so not colonies, and they were kind of shaped like a horn. However, some more pristine horns than others. And so what we see in the more pristine type, Zaphrantis, is labeled in the middle of the slide. We have a bunch of features on these corals that we're going to go through step by step. So first, the calyx, which represents the cup-like portion, similar to the corallite on the tabulate coral, but representative of the cup-like portion of a solitary horn coral. And in the calyx, we have the fossula, which represents a big gap in between the forming septa. And all the septa are radial-like separation structures that form throughout the horn coral, but are pretty much only seen at the top in the calyx, where we have all of these lines that we can look at. And then the only place we don't have one is in the gap in the fossula, which in Latin, fossula is little trench. So now you know why they call it fossula. Then we have septal furrows, which is where the septa affect the outer structure of the horn coral and how you can kind of see where the septa are inside of that coral because of the outer structure furrows. And then you have growth lines, which are horizontal on the horn rather than vertical like the septa. And each of these lines represent new growth from the coral as it grows that direction. And then you have the entire body of it, which is called the epitheca. And then you have more internal structures like tabulae and dissepiments. And here they're just pointing out one. So they say tabula and dissepiment. These are the singular forms of those words. So anyway, tabulae are highlighted here in the red lines, and they're more of the horizontal table-like structures in the internal part of the horn. And then you have the dissepiments, which are kind of more bubbly structures on the outer parts near the edges of the horns. And lastly, we have the apical end, which is the point of the horn. Now getting into the last order of the subclass Zoantheria within the class Anthozoa within the phylum Cnidaria. So this order is the Scleractinian corals. This order, unlike the tabulate and rugose corals, didn't die out in the Permian. In fact, it wasn't even around yet. What happened with the tabulate and rugose corals is they evolved way early on in the Ordovician and went extinct at the Permian. And unlike that, the Scleractinians actually didn't even come about until the Middle Triassic. So after the Permian, you have all the other corals go extinct. Then you have the early Triassic, in which there's this hiatus of corals and reforming structures. And then you have the Middle Triassic, where Scleractinia evolve and then start to become reef builders again. This is really interesting because this makes their origin very controversial. What happened in the early Triassic? Are these Scleractinian corals just more evolved groups of rugose corals, or are they a totally different lineage? We don't know. But people think they're separate than rugose and tabulate corals because even though some of them look similar to rugose corals, they're hexacorals, meaning that they have septa that insert 60 degrees from each other and therefore have numbers of septa divisible by 6 rather than 4 like seen in rugose corals. Additionally, we have this time gap, which also makes us think that they're not part of rugose or tabulata. But instead of starting all over again with coral evolution, starting from the beginning, which is crazy unlikely, what most likely happened, or what most paleontologists think happened, is that a group of soft-bodied sea anemones that previously weren't preservable because they didn't have hard parts evolved the ability to calcify their skeletons and became preservable, which are now represented by the Scleractinian order of corals. And these Scleractinian corals continue today and are the only order of corals left on Earth today. So any live coral you ever see in your lifetime is a Scleractinian. So now I want to discuss evolution. Corals and reef-building organisms in general have gone through a crazy amount of changes throughout the Paleozoic and Mesozoic. So we're going to talk about the different evolutionary events that occurred in all of reef-building organisms on this timeline and how reefs evolved as a whole throughout the Paleozoic and Mesozoic. So first, we have the Archaeocyathan reefs in the early Cambrian. And I'm sorry, I realize that my face right now is probably covering this text. It says Archaeocyathan reefs in early Cambrian. Basically, what we had in the early to middle Cambrian is a reef building group called Archaeocyatha. If you want to know more about this group, you can watch the Porifera video. But basically, they only lived until the middle Cambrian. Because they only lived from the early to middle Cambrian and then went extinct, there was a reef hiatus or a gap in reef building organisms or reefs in general in the middle Cambrian to the early Ordovician. And then you have tabulate corals and rugose corals begin to evolve in the early middle Ordovician, which then allowed reefs to once again proliferate in the Silurian and Devonian, where we have tabulate and rugose corals, along with stromatoporoids and sponges, which we talk about in the Porifera video, along with bryozoans, forming the major reefs during these periods. Then we have the Devonian extinction, which really decimated rugose and tabulate corals. After the Devonian extinction, rugose and tabulate corals were never as abundant and basically caused another reef hiatus in the Carboniferous or Mississippian and Pennsylvanian periods of the Paleozoic. Because of their decline, they weren't able to form major reefs anymore. And then during the Permian, you had some sponges and bryozoans begin to build reefs again, and then the tabulate and rugose corals finally go extinct after straggling on through the late Paleozoic at the End Permian extinction. Then you have another reef hiatus because of this extinction event, and from the end of the Permian to the Middle Triassic, you have an unknown history of what was going on regarding reefs. Then you have the Scleractinian corals evolve, like we talked about, unknown origin, probably a calcified sea anemone that hadn't been fossilized and preserved before, so we have no record of it. And so then these evolved and started building reefs again. And then through the rest of the Mesozoic, rudists, which are a type of mollusk we'll talk about in the mollusk video, dominated reef building and reef environments in the Mesozoic until they went extinct at the end of the Cretaceous. And then Scleractinians became the dominant reef builders again after the Mesozoic Mesozoic throughout the Cenozoic and continue to be the dominant reef builders today. So now for a little bit of Cnidarian ecology. This is going to be pretty short. Basically, we know that predators of corals include things like parrotfish, shown here in the right, and certain crabs, worms, snails, and echinoids. But basically, they're pretty safe. I mean, they have mutually beneficial relationships more so than they have predator-prey relationships, except when it comes to humans. And we'll talk about how we can be killing corals more than any other predator in the sea a little bit later in a different slide. However, before we get to that, we must mention that there are also animals out there that burrow and bore into corals, such as sponges, bivalves, and worms. And then we have different types of corals that can live either with a symbiotic relationship with algae or without that relationship. And so when corals do live in a symbiotic relationship with algae and contain algae called zooxanthellae inside their polyps to grow, they are called hermatypic corals. The algae is called zooxanthellae, and these corals are restricted to clear, shallow water in the photic zone because the algae needs sunlight to photosynthesize. And their temperature range is very strict compared to the ahermatypic corals, which can live in deeper, colder waters down to 1 degree Celsius, and they don't need sunlight to grow. However, they do grow slower than the hermatypic corals, and therefore it is thought that these algae somehow give the hermatypic corals energy boosts or food boosts or some sort of boost to grow faster. But not everything's known about it, so if you'd like to look into it and study these things, they're really amazing. You should go for it. The last thing that I want to discuss is bleaching, because how can we talk about corals without talking about this? We talked already about how there are pretty few predators for corals. However, they are dying at unfortunate rates because of global warming. Global warming is causing the warming and acidification of the ocean, two major factors in killing corals, which host major ecosystems in marine environments. Acidification will literally just dissolve corals, but bleaching is what occurs when the warming of the ocean water causes the algae in symbiotic corals to expel out of the polyps and just leave the coral, even though it relies on this algae. So when the zooxanthellae algae gets expelled, the coral is left bleached, and without the algae to come back, it will eventually die. It is unfortunately estimated that all corals will go extinct in the next few decades, and so this will cause huge mass extinctions of all of the ocean life that relies on reef environments. And so it's important that we understand this, just to understand how dire the global warming situation is. Even though we can't see under the ocean to see all the detrimental effects that global warming has, it is occurring, and it's occurring at a rate that's just terrifying to think about. Sorry to end on such a sad note, but there is good news. The more we talk about it, the more we can work together to fight it. So anyway, thanks so much for watching. I hope this was helpful in learning about the Cnidarian phylum, and I hope that you go ahead and click on the playlist below to watch all of the paleontology phylum videos that I have coming out or are already out, depending on when you're watching this. So anyway, thanks again for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye.